In the previous video, we discussed how hydrolysis reactions are not practical when we think about them from the perspective of making and breaking covalent bonds. Okay, so we figured out that the activation energy going through that pathway was way too high, and we wouldn't have a chemical reaction that would occur in a reasonable time frame. So in this video, what we're going to do is explore a three-step process showing how these hydrolysis reactions occur by following electrons, okay? And that's a really, really important concept as you move through chemistry, is chemistry boils down to following electrons. Electrons dictate the reactivity of chemicals and molecules. Okay, so the first thing that I want to establish here is that when we think about this ester, right, what we know is that this oxygen is partially negative, this oxygen is partially negative, right? They're both electronegative, making this central carbon nice and electropositive. Okay? Atoms that are really electropositive are said to be electron deficient. So they're deficient of electron density. And this makes them really good electrophiles. Okay, an electrophile means that it wants electrons. So it's susceptible to attack by electrons. So it wants electrons. Okay. The counterpart of an electrophile is something that has a lot of electron density. So water, this oxygen, is partially negative. So we call this the nucleophile. So the nucleophile has electrons to give. Okay, and electrophiles and nucleophiles are partners. These chemical reactions are initiated by the partially negative nucleophile, right? So our nucleophile is here. This partially negative nucleophile has a lot of electron density in a lone pair. This lone pair actually reaches out and gives some of that electron density to carbon. This process of sharing electrons creates a new covalent bond. Right, so we end up forming a covalent bond between this oxygen and this carbon. And that's great because we know that we need to do that for our chemical reaction to occur. However, what we've done here, right, so if I redraw this out, we've done something that's really bad. So if we look closely at this central carbon, right, so this carbon right in the middle here, we've given it five bonds. So we have five bonds now, and that's a huge problem because carbon cannot expand its octet. So we've broken rules, so this can't happen. Yet this bond, this step, does occur. So instead of having carbon creating five bonds, we're going to go by that old rule that we used before, that whenever you create a bond, you also have to break a bond. So we've created a bond between oxygen and this carbonyl carbon. So what ends up happening is these lone pairs in the double bond end up getting pushed up onto this oxygen. So this oxygen that's part of the double bond will actually accept two extra electrons. So I'm going to go ahead and just create some space here. So I'm going to erase this bogus structure. And now let's think about what this intermediate is. Okay, so what have we made? So we have R attached to a carbon. This carbon is now attached to this oxygen. This oxygen still has a lone pair. It's attached to this oxygen, which still has two lone pairs, and we have R prime. But now coming up, instead of a double bond, we now have a single bond. And we have this extra pair of electrons on this top oxygen, giving it a formal charge of negative one. And this oxygen at the bottom currently has a formal charge of plus one because it lacks an electron. In the next step of this reaction, we have a very simple swapping of protons. Okay? So this lone pair is going to reach out and it's going to form a bond with this hydrogen, and the electrons in this bond get pushed onto this oxygen. Okay, so let's go ahead and draw this. I have my R attached to the carbon that still has a single bond to an oxygen, has a single bond to an oxygen, but now this oxygen has lost its OH bond and it has a lone pair in place. Now over here, this lone pair became a covalent bond with hydrogen, and now this has a plus one charge. So this is a really important step because we now have a plus one charge. I want to emphasize this plus one charge here. This plus one charge is occurring on the oxygen that needs to leave, right? So we need to break this bond. So by moving the positive charge onto the oxygen in the bond that gets broken is absolutely essential. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and remove this arrow so it doesn't be so it's not confusing. And now the last step in this reaction is I'm going to take this lone pair and reform my double bond. Okay, so I reform a double bond. This carbon now has a new bond, so we need to break a bond. This pair of electrons that are in this covalent bond get pushed on over to oxygen. Okay, and this is the last step in our reaction. We have now broken the bond that we need to break. So if I move up here a little bit, let's redraw this. So I have R. This carbon is now double bonded to the oxygen again, and it's bonded to an OH. Okay, this part of the molecule is now my alcohol. So I have my R prime attached to the oxygen and attached to a hydrogen. Okay, so and as it turns out, this three-step process is exactly how this reaction happens, and it avoids the formation of any unpaired electrons. And that's really important because it's the unpaired electrons that are such high energy. So this reaction pathway dramatically minimizes the energy that is required for a hydrolysis reaction. Okay, let's go ahead and go through this process one more time with an amide. So you can see these three steps again, because these three steps you're going to be responsible for redoing on new molecules. And this time let's go ahead and use a real molecule. So let's say we have this compound, this amide. Okay, and we want to hydrolyze this bond. So this reaction is going to undergo hydrolysis. We know that during hydrolysis, we always break the bond between the carbonyl oxygen and this nitrogen. Okay, so we know that this carbon is partially positive, making it the electrophile, and on our oxygen, and on our water, we have a partially negative nucleophile. So in the first step, a lone pair from the nucleophile reaches out, forms a covalent bond with the electrophile, and a pair of electrons from the double bond get pushed up to the oxygen. So that's step number one. And our product here, we've destroyed the double bond, created a negative one charge on this oxygen. I'm still attached to the nitrogen here and everything is attached to it, but now coming down I have my oxygen that used to be water and it now has the positive charge. Okay, we need to move the positive charge over to the atom in the bond that gets broken. So in the next step here, I want this lone pair on nitrogen to reach out, pick up that hydrogen, and that lone pair is going to be pushed over to oxygen. The product of this looks really similar to the second reaction there, the second molecule, but now I have a positive charge on my nitrogen, not on my oxygen. And the final step, the lone pair from this oxygen falls down, forms double bond again, and this bond breaks, creating our amine. So our products here are going to be a carboxylic acid and an amine. So the most important points to think about, the most important things to think about are the steps and why they're important. The first step, we have a nucleophile attacking the electrophile. In the second step, we are shifting the position of the positive charge. And in the third step, we are recreating the double bond between carbon and oxygen. And by doing so, we break the bond between that carbonyl carbon and the nitrogen. Okay, this will definitely take practice. You're going to have to practice these. Draw out as many amides and as many esters as you need to, and just practice these three steps.